Welcome to Frank Buckley Interviews. It's the 50th anniversary of the birth of the internet this year, and tonight's guest was there when it all started. He's one of the fathers of the internet. My guest is the distinguished professor of computer science at UCLA, Professor Leonard Kleinrock.
Frank Buckley Interviews starts now.
The first message ever sent over the internet happened in Professor Kleinrock's lab at UCLA. That's where we sat down to talk about how that moment came to be and what's happened since.
So in order to log in, we just had to type LOG. Now, here was a new technology, this thing called packet switching. We weren't sure if it's going to work in this first implementation. So we got on the phone. Charlie typed the L in the S. Bill, you get the L? Yep, got the L. Type the O, you get the O? Yep, got the O. Type the G, you get the G? Crash. The SRI machine crashed. As a result, the very first message ever on the internet was lo, as in lo and behold. We didn't plan a good message, but those two letters are the most perfect, most profound, most succinct message we could have asked for. And it's something that will go down in history once the public becomes aware of it.
More on the birth of the internet with Professor Leonard Kleinrock when we come back. Professor Kleinrock, thank you for joining us on Frank Buckley Interviews. It's great to be in this room with you. Tell us about this room.
You're in a holy place right now. This is the room where the internet took birth. It's a place where the first switch arrived. We call those switches routers today. It's sitting right over here behind me. It's a place where the first message was sent. We were the first node of the internet. And then the network increased with numbers of nodes, now finally hundreds of millions of nodes. And it all began in this room in 1969.
Take me back to 1969 and the birth of the internet. You were in this room with who?
I was here with one of my software programmers. He was a student, Charlie Klein. And we were the first node in September of 69. And next month, in October of 69, Stanford Research Institute, SRI, 350 miles to the north, got their router as well. And we had a high-speed line between the two switches. And we decided now to use the network the way it was designed. We wanted to test it. And the way the network was designed was that I could sit at a machine down here and log on to a machine across the country or up north and log into that machine as if I was a local user and use that machine as if I was there. That was the whole idea of the network, to basically reduce the distance. And now we had two machines. We had one down here connected to our switch. SRI had a computer connected to their switch. And all we wanted to do was to log in from our terminal here, connected to our computer, connected to our switch, connected to a high-speed line, connected to their switch, connected to their computer, and run something. So that was the idea. Now, to log in, you have to type L-O-G. And that remote machine is smart enough to know what you're doing. It'll type the IN for you. So in order to log in, we just had to type LOG. Now, here was a new technology, this thing called packet switching. We weren't sure if it's going to work in this first implementation. So just to check on what's going on, we had Charlie with a telephone connection to the programmer up at SRI. His name was Bill Duval, with a telephone connection just to communicate what's going on. Now, look at the irony here. We're using a telephone network to prove a new technology which is going to eat the lunch of the telephone network. And we did.
Right.
So we got on the phone. Charlie typed the L in the S. Bill, you get the L? Yep, got the L. Type the O, you get the O? Yep, got the O. Type the G, you get the G? Crash. The SRI machine crashed. As a result, the very first message ever on the internet was lo, as in lo and behold. We didn't plan a good message, but those two letters are the most perfect, most profound, most succinct message we could have asked for. And it's something that will go down in history once the public becomes aware of it.
When the system crashed, were you disappointed?
Disappointed is the wrong word. Remember, we were engineers trying to accomplish a task. Something doesn't work, you figure out why and you fix it. And we did. In fact, we didn't recognize that that evening was a momentous event.
So you didn't recognize the historic nature of that moment?
Not at all.
It was a task that engineers were trying to accomplish.
Yeah, we were testing the system. It just came up. Let's try it. We didn't have a camera. We didn't have a tape recorder. We didn't have a good message ready. We're just doing our job.
Right.
And that's actually an important observation, because this whole enterprise of creating the thing we now call the internet was done as an engineering research challenge. And that was the mentality we brought, the expectations, the ambitions or lack thereof. We're just doing a job. And we weren't looking to make money, to make fame, just do a good job. Someone else uses what you do. That's the gratification.
And you wanted to be able to log into another computer somewhere else. To what end?
Well, typically, the reason the ARPANET, this network, was created was so that we researchers could share the research facilities of other researchers who had special capabilities. Mm. For example, at the University of Utah, they had excellent graphics. University of Illinois, high performance computing. SRI, database. UCLA, performance modeling. I would love to have replicated the graphics capability here, and so would every other researcher. And the funding agency said, wait a minute, we can't give everybody everything. If you want to use a special resource, log on through a network we're going to create, the ARPANET, which became the internet, and use it there, which is a wonderful resource sharing idea. In fact, if you think about today's shared economy, Airbnb, Uber, using things that others are not using when they're not using it. Mm-hmm. It's exactly what this was. We were going to share machines when they were not being used, and sharing the underlying capability of the network. The underlying technology which made this network so successful is that we were sharing the high bandwidth paths dynamically as people needed it, instead of assigning them for long periods of time, and people may take smoke, take a cup of coffee and not send anything. We'd grab it when those kinds of events occurred.
And just backing up a moment, before that moment when you logged on in this room, you had, as a math theory, and it helped me explain this in a way that someone like me who didn't do too well in math can understand, you had accomplished this theory of packet switching. You had proven it out. Tell me what that means.
Let me go back a little bit. I was an MIT graduate student in the early 60s. And I was surrounded by computers. And I was basically forced, convinced, to go after a PhD. I didn't want to. I was married. My son was just born. I'd gotten my master's, had a good research job. Terrific. They said, you got to get a PhD. I said, I don't want to. You got to get it. I said, OK, if I'm going to do that, I'm going to work for the best professor I know. And I want to do something that has impact. Hmm. And so I looked around, and I was surrounded by computers. And I realized that sooner or later, they're going to have to talk to each other. And there was no existing technology which would allow that to be done efficiently. And I realized that this idea of dynamic sharing, where the communication links in the telephone network, which was the only network available at the time, were being used very inefficiently. It was a constant link between two users, and if they stopped using it, it was still assigned to them until they hung up. In data, you can't do that. You have to find a way to grab that channel when someone else is not using it. Grab that bedroom in Airbnb when someone else is not using it. Dynamically share. So that was the idea. Mm. So I had an approach. It was a new problem. Nobody looked at it, had looked at it before. And I realized it would have impact. Computers were going to eventually talk to each other. So that's why I looked at this problem. And the approach I used, I just tried to describe, was the idea of dynamically sharing the underlying capability of the network as the need arose. You don't wait for something that's not there yet, just use it immediately. So I developed this mathematics of what we now call packet switching networks. And it elaborated on the advantages of dynamic sharing, on the advantages of large systems, on the advantages of distributed control. I laid the theory out, and I published it in my dissertation. It became a book, and nobody cared.
Nobody cared?
Nobody cared. AT&T, the biggest network company in the world, said, it won't work. And even if it does, we want nothing to do with it. They would say, little boy, go away. So little boy went away. And other people were looking at these kinds of things, too. I laid out the mathematics. Other people looked at some of the engineering aspects of such a network. Mm-hmm. And all of this lay fallow until the Advanced Research Projects Agency, which President Eisenhower created as a response to Sputnik, said, we need a network to connect together, basically, all these resources. And so suddenly, ARPA said, let's create an ARPANET, the The theory was there, the need was there, let's go. And basically, that led to the initiation of this location as being the first node because we had the capability to do it. But the mathematics was laid out early on by myself and some others who participated in the engineering.
So first of all, just what is this?
It's a mini computer, state of the art at the time. 1968 it came out, very high speed. Its main attribute was it could handle many interrupts simultaneously. Imagine many packets coming in. That was the capability. They took this machine, they changed the hardware, and so I'll show you the inside if you
please.
Want.
Yeah, please.
It's so ugly, it's beautiful,
oh
right?
Oh my God.
And it consists of logic, memory, modems, power supplies, fans, all kinds of capability. And it has a unique odor. And in the movie, I actually, you can smell it. It's got an old odor, which is especially good. But it's a Honeywell DDP-516. That was the name of the basic machine. And they altered it, and they made it run. And they did this back in Cambridge. They shipped the thing out here, air freight. We turned it on, and it kept running. And it connected to that machine over there. And a month later, we connected this over the high-speed line up north.
Oh, my
God.
So
it was really... Quite a device.
And you, can we say this on the show?
Yeah.
You hid this from UCLA for years.
You bet, I did.
Because they wanted to get rid of it.
They started to throw away bits and pieces of it. There's a paper tape reader that was thrown away. The modems were thrown away. These are the modem interface units. And I had to take it and move it into an office across from mine and lock the door. Because the facilities people just wanted to throw it away, and they threw away a lot of good equipment.
And you knew the historical value.
It was no question. I mean, after all, imp number one, you can't beat that. There's only two of these machines. There were many dozens deployed across the country. There's only two left. All the rest were thrown away. And this is number one.
My God. Was there a moment when you did sit back and think, and this may be after the moment that you logged in here and got this going, was there a moment when you sat back and thought, oh, this is more than just connecting researchers and their computers? This could be something that the average Joe would someday use.
The answer is yes and no. 2 months before that first switch arrived here, UCLA put out a press release in which they quoted me as describing how this network would be used and what the future would look like. And in that, there's an exact quote. And to paraphrase it, I said the network would be always on, always available. Anybody with any device could get on at any time for any location, and it would be invisible, the same way electricity is basically invisible to the user. So I had an idea of where it would be used and how it would be used. That was going to be a grand thing. But what I totally missed in that vision, was the whole idea of social networking.
Hmm.
I missed that it was a people-to-people communication, not a machine-to-machine or person-to-machine. It was not until email came in later that I realized, this is about people communicating.
Mm.
So I did have a vision. I saw this would be big, but I never imagined it would permeate the consumer world, the public world, the education world the way it has.
There are other names associated with the birth of the internet and or the World Wide Web or the information superhighway. Who are some of the people that you believe are responsible alongside your contribution to what we have today?
So there's a long list of names, and I'll give them to you in a minute. But before I do that, let me point out, if none of those people, including myself, had ever been born, we'd have the internet today.
Hmm. Why do you say that?
This idea was waiting to happen. It was in the air. There were visionaries as far back as 1908. Nikola Tesla talked about a thing which looks like the internet today. Over 100 years ago, H.G. Wells, Vannevar Bush, Licklider, many of us expressed visions. So if these particular people that we're going to talk about, including myself, had never been born, it was going to happen. It was in the air.
Mm.
So having said that, I'll give you some of the names that are often associated with it. People like Paul Barron. He was also working on some of the engineering and technology issues of packet switching. Donald Davies came a little later. Larry Roberts, a classmate of mine at MIT, he was the chief scientist at ARPA who managed this project. Some of the people here at UCLA who helped it happen, people like Steve Crocker, Vin Cerf, J. John Postel, Charlie Klein, the programmer, a number of those. Bob Kahn, who was at BBN, who helped make that machine, and other people at BBN is Bolt, Baranek, and Newman, a group in Cambridge that basically configured that machine. Tim Berners-Lee, Dave Clark, Licklider, who was at ARPA, Bob Taylor, who was the head of the computer group at ARPA at the time. I mean, the list goes on and on and on. I mean, it's a huge list. And, you know, Bob Metcalf, Ethernet. I've got a list of over 100 names we could talk about.
I see.
And all made important contributions, and all of them recognized in one way or another.
When this started to get to the public, when it went beyond the researchers and it became available to us, was that a satisfying time for you?
So you just described a couple of decades.
Yeah.
So let's
try to fast forward.
Well, no, but that's important.
Yes.
It started out that ARPA supported research among computer scientists. As I said, that was Eisenhower's response to Sputnik, where we were caught with our pants down as having failed in science and engineering. So we had a bunch of computer scientists using this simple network, doing the things we do, sending files around, doing email, some research papers. But it's a closed community. Meanwhile, in the 1980s, the National Science Foundation deployed a number of supercomputers around the country to do very interesting work. And toward the mid-80s, they said, well, we ought to connect these supercomputers together. Aha, the ARPANET. So they connected them into the net, and they found the network was a little bit too slow, so they introduced something called NSFNet and allowed these machines to talk. But the effect was, suddenly, the community had enlarged from computer scientists to include chemists, physicists, biologists, physiologists, oceanographers, a much broader community. Now, where do chemists work? Well, they work in universities, and they work in research labs at major chemical companies. So imagine such a group inside a chemical company using the ARPANET. And what are they doing with the ARPANET? Or the internet, what's now called, send an email. Mostly, that was the major application. Well, everybody else in that organization outside the research lab says, boy, that looks interesting. I'd like some email also. So the staffers, the executives, the rest of the corporation, and that's when the dot-coms began to appear, sort of a byproduct of this availability in the commercial world. So now we had a need on the part of the dot-coms. We had a gigabit backbone coming about at the same time, thanks to Al Gore. So we had the capability, we had a need, but we didn't have an easy way to use it. We needed a good interface. In the early 90s, the World Wide Web came in. World Wide Web is what? It's a simple graphical user interface that allows us. In fact, it was implemented by Mark Andreessen at the University of Illinois in a thing called Mosaic. He took the idea of basically hypertext and presented it as a graphical user interface. Now it was easy to use, there was a need to use it, there was a capability to drive it, and now it began to reach out beyond the commercial world to the consumer. And now we began to see a whole new flavor of use of the internet. Suddenly, the average consumer, the businessman, educational institutions were beginning to use it. Mm. And that changed the complexity.
When you saw this happening, when you saw that I at home could dial up AOL from my house and your colleagues could communicate with other colleagues and there were commercial interests now jumping on board, did you have a moment of this could get out of control, or were you thinking this is fantastic?
The latter. In fact, I used to fly in American Airlines quite a bit. I look at American Way, the magazine, mm-hmm. and I used to count, before the internet became popular, how many ads were about computers, and began to grow. Then how many ads talk about networking, and it began to grow, and I felt really good that this thing I was involved with was now reaching out and having some impact. Mm.
It's not fair to ask someone who is still in the middle of his stride, who is working, who is doing the research, you continue to lecture, to talk about legacy, but I'm going to ask you anyway. What is your legacy? How do you want to be remembered?
Mostly I want to be remembered for developing the mathematical theory of these networks, for the intellectual contribution I made way back as a graduate student, because I uncovered some very important principles, and they've generated whole spheres of science that have continued to pursue these ideas. The fact that I was here when the first node was created is enriching and pleasurable, but that's not the way I want to be remembered. I want to be remembered for the intellectual contribution I made at the mathematical side, at the understanding what's going on. Because I mentioned before, I wanted to work for the best professor at MIT. That professor, his name was Claude Shannon. You probably never heard of him. Whoever's watching this program should look him up, Claude Shannon. He created what we call information theory and coding theory and much of data networking. And he was always interested in working on important problems. And he had a wonderful knack of mixing mathematical excellence with intuitive reasoning. And it's those that I brought together as a result that gives me the most pleasure. And I want the young students who are watching this now to go after those goals, to make a creative contribution from here, not from here.
Professor, thank you for your contribution and for your time.
My pleasure.
We just showed you a portion of the interview with Professor Kleinrock. If you'd like to hear the entire conversation, check out the Frank Buckley Interviews podcast. It's available wherever you listen to podcasts. We'd love to hear your feedback on the show. Tag me on social media at Frank Buckley TV on Twitter and on Instagram, or post a comment on the Frank Buckley Facebook page. If you'd like to share today's TV show with folks around the world, find it on YouTube. Just search for Frank Buckley Interviews, Leonard Kleinrock. Thanks for joining us. We'll see you next time.